lines on that first page. Okay, so now the last number system that I'm going to talk to you about, but really just super briefly, is called the parametric system. Okay, parametrics, you're going to see that they have the parameter t in there. You know, like when you guys are doing rectangular, you have the parameters x and y for rectangular system. When you go into complex numbers, then you have a new parameter called I, and that allows you to move into the polar system. And then you get to parametric equations, and you start studying about how an object is moving, how a point is moving along a particular type of curve. And you're going to see that the curves are the ones that you learned in algebra, the parabola, and the hyperbola that go out like this, or up and out like that, the circle, the ellipse, those same shapes, only they're going to be in parametric form. So when you're studying parametric equations, you're going to see that there's a t in there. And that talks about, we start to drag in the concept of time and how a point is moving along a particular curve, whether it be a parabola or whether it be an ellipse, how a point is moving along that curve with respect to time. So that's the new parameter that you're seeing in there. We're going to switch the mode on our calculator, and we're going to be able to get these parametric equations in both rectangular form and parametric form. Okay, so like you're going to see, the very first ones are super easy. We're just, you know, giving you a way to move from rectangular system into parametric system. Here's an example of what the equations look like. So you'll have an x and a y, but you're going to drag in parameter t. So one of the questions would be super easy. It's just more or less substitution. Find an ordered pair that goes with these equations. Okay, so like for instance, these are the two equations. This is one equation. This is the other equation. And then they're saying get the x and the y. What's the ordered pair, x and y, such that t is equal to 5. So super easy. Just plug the t value of 5 wherever you see a t. So if you want to get an x and a y pair like this, you're trying to go for this. Come over here. Show the work. It's very simple. It's just t plus 4, and you put the 5 in there. Okay, so that's the front part of it. Back part of it is how to get the y value. Use the equation for y that involves this t value. And again, the t value is 5, so you put 5 in there. You end up with 25 minus 3, and that's equal to 22. So there's like one or two problems like that in this section. Okay, this review that I included for you, I've spoken about this because it comes up in other sections, even in the parametric equation. Even in the polar equations, I started talking to you about how do you tell whether something is a parabola, how do you tell whether something's an ellipse. So I collected all that information for you here again. I think I had already given it to you once, and let's review it. Because they're going to ask you to tell them what kind of shape it is. Okay, so again, the parabola is the most distinguishing feature of a parabola, typically one square. Okay, if the square is on the x's, you're talking about the vertical ones, either up or down, depending on what kind of value is in front of it. If the square is on the x and this value right here is positive, then it opens up. And when if there's a square on the x and the value is negative, it opens down. Okay, but then you shouldn't have a square on both the x and the y. So the distinguishing feature of a parabola is that you will only see a square on either the x or the y. These are the sideways parabolas. When the square switches from being on the x to being on the y, that means you're either this way or this way. It opens this way. If the a is positive, it opens the other way when it's negative. Circle. How do you tell the difference between a circle and an ellipse? Because they're going to ask you to pick out one of the
matrix that go in the equation for the circle. See how there's no, how the values here are both 1? You'll have squares on both of them, a plus hit the symbol. In other words, the x expression will be positive, so will the y. It's equal coefficients right here. Okay, and that could be a 5 and a 5, a 1 and a 1, just as long as they're equal. When they are no longer equal, they will give them different names. Okay, notice the similarities between the circle and the ellipse. This x expression is squared, the y expression is squared. They're both positive. All of that's the same. The only thing that's different from here to here is that this coefficient, which is the over a squared, is not the same as this one, because that's why they have different names. That's why they call this. And the only reason we put it in fraction form is because it's really super easy to graph when it's in fraction form. Because when you take the square root of this, it's just how far you go this way and this way. If you take the square root of that, it's how far you go that way. But anyway, they're different. And so the circle becomes like a squat egg. And so that's what we call the elliptical shape. So the difference between this and this, not that much, other than these coefficients are equal. These are not. Those are considered the coefficients. We always get the ellipse and the hyperbola in this form right here with one over there, because if we wanted to graph it, that you could do it by hand really more easy than you could, more easily than you could on the calculator. Hyperbola, the thing that gives that away, it's the only one that has a negative. You'll have a square on both, but one of the expressions will be negative. Okay, the one expression that's positive, you see how this one has a negative in front of it and this one doesn't? The one that's positive, you know that when you're doing a hyperbola, there's these things called hyperbolic wings. So whichever expression is positive, like if your x expression is positive, then those hyperbolic wings open with respect to this axis right here. The expression that's squared and positive, so the hyperbolic wings would run like that. If this was the negative one and this one was the positive one, then the wings would open up and down. So, I don't know how much graphing they made you do in there, but let's look at these problems. So, I'm going to be referring to this whenever they say, tell what the shape is, what the curve is, the end of the curve. Okay, so let's do number 2. All right, so in order for you to do these problems, what you're going to have to know, because they're going to give you things that triggered them. And they're going to expect you to go from these parametric trig, they're parametric because they have a t in them. They're going to expect you to go from these parametric equations that have the trig words in them all the way over to this. But you're going to have to know this to do the Pythagorean theorem, so what will help you get from one system to another. And these are called the Pythagorean trig identities. Yes, you can use Pythagorean theorem on a triangle, and then it's hypotenuse squared is leg squared plus leg squared, but there was also the trig version. There were 3 different trig versions of the Pythagorean theorem. So one of them went like this. This is probably the one you know the best. Sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1. And instead of theta, since we're talking t's here for parametrics, I'll just say sine squared 2 is cosine squared 2 is equal to 1. So that's one of them. Then there was another one that had secant and tan in it. So it went like this. And then the third one is just the co-version of this. Instead of tan, cotan. Instead of secant, cosecant. So memorize these 3. You needed these from chapter 6 all the way through. Okay, so this same equation, only with cos in front of these, that was the third one. You're only going to use these when So I could tell you step one here is that you can isolate the trig word. Get the trig word all by itself. So in other words, see how this trig word is being multiplied by 2? Get the 2 out of there. Let's divide the 2 right over to the other side.
So let's divide by 2. Divide by 2, and you then have this equation. I'm going to finish my work down here. X over 2 is equal to secant t.
You see these Pythagorean, and then let's do the other one too, and then I'll talk about the Pythagorean. The other one, isolate the trig word. Divide by 5, divide by 5. I'll put that down here. So it's pi over 5 is equal to tan t. And go pick out one of the 3 identities that involves these 2 trig words, and that would be this one right here. 1 plus tan squared equals secant squared. But can you see how the word tan and secant are both in their squared form? And that identity, get yours in the squared form. Go take these little baby equations that you have. Get them into square form by just squaring each side. Okay, so I'm going to square this side as well as this. I'm going to square this side as well as this. That will take me into secant squared is equal to x squared over 4. You know, when you're squaring a fraction, you got to square the top and the bottom. This one will be y squared over 25 is equal to tan squared. And then you select the Pythagorean identity that you're going to need. One that involves these 2 trig terms. So let's write that down here. 1 plus tan squared is equal to secant squared. And now go plug in. Remember, we're going to pass from these parametric equations into rectangular form. We just have, whenever you see rectangular, you should have nothing but x's and y's. That's what the rectangular system is. Okay, so right now, I'm going to get rid of this. I'm going to get rid of the parameter t as well as the trig word and go completely into rectangular form. Tan squared right here, y squared over 25. So I no longer have the word tan with parameter t. Okay, in place of this, I'm putting what's equivalent to the y squared over 25 is equal to secant squared, and secant squared is x squared over 4. Then look at your choices to see how they want you to get that. And let's see. Looks like almost all of them have, like, the x and the y expression on the same side. I'm going to get mine like that. Okay, so let's see. I guess what I'll do is, now, let's see. All the ones in all these answers are positive, right? So that's the one. Leave it where it is, because where it's at right now, it's positive. And you can bring this y squared over to join this so that the x's and the y's are on the same side with the 1 by itself. So it's 1 is equal to x squared over 4, you're bringing this over here, which now makes it negative. So which answer is that? Yep. It doesn't matter if you flip-flop the sides, right? When you flip-flop both sides, when you flip-flop both sides at one time, it doesn't change any of the signs. But when you're moving a single term from one side to the other, that changes. Okay, so we got D. All right, find a rectangular equation for this. Do not use a calculator. And I think we did everything we had to do. Okay, so same thing here. So I gave you a couple of these because this is mostly what's on the test. You might have to graph one. Just isolate the trig word, so divide the 10 right off of it, and you have, I'll put my work over here, x over 10 is equal to cosine squared. Now, this one's already in the squared form, so that's a little bit less work. Likewise, right here, divide by 10, and you have equal to sine squared. Once you've isolated these trig terms, go select the Pythagorean identity that you're going to use. It'll be the one that contains these two trig words, and that is sine squared plus cosine squared is equal to 1. And then go plug in. You're trying to get rid of the parameter t and the trig words. What's equivalent to sine squared is y over 10. And what's equivalent to cosine squared is x over 10. Okay, then they want to know what kind of shape is this? What kind of shape is it when every single variable is first degree? It's a line. Okay? The reason that things curl up is because they begin to be second degree, third degree. Okay, so everything that's on that page that we just flipped away from, they all have squares on them. The only one that doesn't have a square on anything, x's or y's, is a straight line. Okay, so when they ask you to pick, you can leave this like this, or you can get rid of the fractions if you want. Now, what is the rectangular equation for y? Okay, so see how they're forcing you to give it like this, where the y is by itself? Why don't we clean this equation up, getting it just the way they want us to get it. So, if you're going to get the y by itself, you should get rid of the fractions first. Just multiply by 10. That'll kick out the 10 that's right here, giving you just y. It'll kick out the 10 that's right there, giving you just x. You got to use the 10. You got to multiply the 10 by everything. So it's like you're putting it here, you're putting it here, and you're putting it here. Here they just cancel. Here they cancel. But over here, you get 10. So if you're going to try and get this answer right here, the way they want it, then you swing this x over to where the 10 is, and then you have y by itself. So they're kind of leading you into how they want you to give the answer. Again, that's a straight line because x is first degree, y is first degree. I didn't put that here because I'm thinking, after getting through intermediate and college algebra, that you're rock solid on what a first-degree equation looks like. There's no way to get through the classes not knowing that. These are more like what we talk about when we're in trig and pre-cal. So try to remember, throw that on there. If you don't already know that, add it to this list, that a straight line looks like this. This is just one way to write it. Remember learning that quite a bit in your algebra classes, where if you were going to graph it, you would just go to the y-intercept first, put a point, and then you would use rise over run to get the second point, and bam, you had the line. So add that to this list if you need to. Okay, let's go to number 4. Why don't you try to do that one? I did 2 of them already. Why don't you try to see, try your hand at that. see what you got here. All right, so in step one, if you were following what I did in the last two problems, you're going to divide both sides by 2, and you'll have x over 2 is equal to sine of t. And then if you're doing the same thing with the y, dividing both of those sides by 3, y over 3 is equal to cosine t. Now, you know all those Pythagorean identities were in the square form, right? That's the one that right now. You want these to be in their square form, yet the way they are when I divide it, they aren't. So I'm going to square this side as well as this side. So this is like the first one that I did. Okay, so this will be x squared over 4 is equal to sine squared. And this one will be y squared over 9 is equal to cosine squared. Why did I divide by 4? Can we care about that right? Y squared over 9. And then don't forget, select one of the identities, the one that has these true boards in it. Sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1. And then plug in. Okay, so sine squared is this, x squared over 4. And the cosine squared is y squared over 9. Okay, look at how to graph things, because they're easier to graph angular than they are in parametric. So, what shape is this? Okay, I think it's all this, that little capital off the computer on the first page. Ellipse, circle, what do you think? Well, you're all saying different things. Okay, parabola. Okay, let's go through all the ones. It cannot be a parabola, because parabolas only have a square on either the x or the y, not both. You're going to have to memorize that. No, that's the one I'm doing right now. So, it's not a parabola. Why is it not a circle? I mean, why is that a parabola? Obvious. You've got too many squares in it. Coefficients. Yeah. Like, you consider the coefficient of this the 1/4. And you consider the coefficient of this 1/9. So, you see those are different, right? Okay, and it's best when you're doing an ellipse to have in this form where you where it's set equal to 1 and its pieces are fractured. Super easy. Look how easy it is to graph it. Okay, all you're going to do is go like this. If there's nothing being subtracted from the x, you know, like this could say x plus 1 with the square. That means the center is right at the origin. So the center is right at the origin for the x and the y. And all you're going to do is go like this. This is called the bigger value. Just happens to, when you're doing ellipses, the bigger value is called a. So it's called a squared. That's actually a squared, because that's how the equation goes. Y squared over whatever is underneath is, and it's squared. So a squared. This is b, the smaller value. And square root of that would be 2. So all you're going to do is see how this value is associated with the x, because I've made the x. You're going to move as many units to the right and to the left on the x-axis. So just go out 1, 2, go to point. Go out 1, 2, put a point here. Then on your y-axis, you're going to go up 3 and down 3. So 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. That's it. Connect it. What's your shot? Okay, so there's the graph of it. If they ask you if the equation was it, let's see, x squared was over 4. So it's this one. All right, go to number 5. Let's try and put something in the calculator just so we can get familiar with, I told you everything you needed to know just so you get familiar with putting a parametric equation in there. You're going to touch mode. You're going to make sure you know all your graphs on the final are in radians, right? Everything's in radians when you're graphing, whether it's polar or trig functions or even these parametric ones. Okay, so go in there and make those changes on the mode key. You're going to choose parametrics, radians. Okay, so I'm in radians and I'm in parametrics. And then click out of there after you've pressed enter on radians and parametrics. Okay, now go to the y is equal to where you always feed in your functions. And whatever it is you're graphing, you can go and graph. Okay, go ahead and put in what you have here. You're going to put in for x, 3t minus 5. And for y, you're going to put in t squared. The t is just where the x is, where you would usually get an x, and now it turns into t. And put a square on it. Then, where it says t is in the range negative 3 to 2, you're going to go to window for that. Go to the window and set the parameters for t. So I'm going to second quit, touch window up at the top, and go negative 3 to 2 on the t min and t max. That's what the negative 3 is. It's your t min. This is T max. I just copied off my paper. I left it for you. Always when they give you two numbers, that's the min and the max. Whether you're in the XY system or whether you're in the T system, the front is the min and the back is the max. What does it look like? Any of these? 3t minus 5, and then what else is it? You know what else? You know what else we could do to refine it? We could do the x min and the x max. Let me show you how to do that. I mean, I gave you a suggested window down there for the x min and the x max, but really, if you wanted to get the x min and the x max for yourself, this is how you do it, because that'll refine your picture. Come over here to the worksheet. See how you have an expression for x and a t min and a t max value? Take the x min and the x max from t min and the t max. Like, for instance, here's my x. I'm going to get another pencil. That lead is run out. I mean, you could use this already if you want to, but I just want to show you in general how to get your own x min and x max if I don't give it to you, because really these numbers, I stretched them out a little bit. Okay, so here's your expression for x, 3t minus 5, right? And then weren't you given a t min, t max window? Okay, so this is the t min, and this is the t max. These things will give you a x max and an x min. Okay, here's my x min. Just use the t min to get that. So this is what, negative 27 minus -32. And if you wanted to get the x max, then use that same expression, 3t minus 5, but this time use the t max. You would have 1.
I don't even have to swap with that problem. It's like a random thing in space. I don't know.
I have no idea why I plugged that in.
Okay, so what was it? Negative 9 and then minus 5? Fix that.
Negative 9 minus 5, so that should have been negative 14.
Okay, then the other one was where I'm plugging in the back one, so that's 3 times 2 is 6, 6 minus 5 is 1. So you can use this as the x-min and the x-max for this problem. And likewise, if you wanted to get the y-min and the y-max, same thing. So there's x-min and x-max. The expression for y is t squared. But that equation can allow you to get a y-min and a y-max. If you go y-min, use the t-min, and get the y-min. You can also get the y-max. Because this is negative. Let me see what this looks like. Let's try this edge of the window. And where it says X-Men. I mean, I might have come up with these to make the picture look better. So let's see. The Y-Men is negative 14. I mean, X-Men is negative 14. Let's just see if it makes the picture look any better.
I set them like this because when I did the y-min and the y-max using plug-in numbers, it made the picture, like, really big. So let me see. Let me try one other thing.
Now, there's two things you could do to get a better picture than what we just got with the actual numbers. You can either do zoom fit, or you can use these numbers that I gave you here. Either one will get you a nice picture. See, this is my picture with zoom fit. Do you see which one that has to be? What choice is that? If you use these parameters that I suggested for you, just because I messed around with them after seeing that these gave a picture that was so big, and didn't able to get one of these nicely, although you can tell it's the only one that goes up like that. We did not have anything like that. So just my process of elimination. But this gives you a nice picture. This gives you a nice picture. Let's get number 6. Do you have any questions? To go into rectangular, you want to get rid of evidence of any other number system. Anything that talks about polarism or parametrics or anything, you just want x's and y's. So you can do that real simple here. The substitution. Go and take, let's see. You can just plug in for t. You could go like this. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to plug in right over here. Okay, there's two different ways you can do it, but I'm going to start with the x. For
first thing I'm going to, if I'm going to plug in for T, I need an expression for T that has, you know, X's in it. So I'm going to go X plus 5. In other words, I'm bringing this over here, trying to isolate the T. I'm going to divide by 3 on both sides. And there's my expression for T, having only rectangular information in it. Then I'm going to come back up to this equation, and I'm going to substitute. So I got over here, I have T squared. My T value, according to the first expression, is X plus 5 over 3. So you can write this a little nicer by keeping the square on this expression, or you know, actually expanding it, but you really don't need to do that. You can keep this wrapped up in parentheses with a square. I need to foil it out. I don't think they're going to make you do that. And then also square the bottom. Right? It's in rectangular form, but it tells you that it's a parabola. Because weren't the parabolas the only ones that you didn't have a square on both letters? So that this has to be a parabola. This happens to be a parabola that opens up, and that's because what's in front of here is a positive. And that is what we got here. Look, we got a parabola. The only reason it's chopped off like that is because you had a restricted range in there, a restricted connectivity. So the shape is going to be the same whether you put it in a parametric form and you let your calculator do it, or whether you put it in XY form and do it by hand. It's just that when it's in XY form, it's easier to do by hand. If it's in parametric form, then your calculator can handle it. And the equivalent rectangular equation, we just got that. It's on the previous page. Y is equal to X plus 5 squared over 9. Just get it in the form that they want. Okay, 6. Graph the plane curve defined by the given parametric equation. Then find the rectangular equation. Okay, so this will be the last one. Okay, so now what you can do here, graph the length curve, then find the rectangular. Okay, let's graph first. Seconds, square root t divided by 2. They said to put in a 0 and a 4, and we might have to do our own X min and X max. Okay, so put the 0 and the 4 in there. I have everything entered. I entered my two equations, but I want to see what the X min and the X max is, so I'm going to do that here on the paper. Okay, so let's see. Again, this is the T min. Get an X min and an X max. So that would be 0 over 2. X min would be 0. X max would be, use that T, 4 divided by 2, square root of 2. I get your calculator and put that in for X and X max, these two values right here. Okay, then do the y min and the y max. I'm going to do those down here. Y min, there's your expression for y, 3t minus 5, using the t min right here. This will be negative 5, y max, same expression, 3t minus 5. And using the t max value now. So this is going to be 12 minus 5, 7. So put in negative 5 and 7 for 1 and 1 out. See if you can pick the picture. All right, so the two that you can rule out, is it pretty clear to you that you can rule out A and B? Okay, then look at C and D. And the thing that you have in your pocket look nothing like that, nothing like that. Now pick between these two. What was your Y max here? Because isn't one of these a little taller than the other one? They look pretty darn similar, but one has a Y max of 10, and this one has a Y max of about, what are these, about 7? What's our Y max 7? That's a picture. Okay, congratulations on finishing the class. Have a beautiful day. We are done. I'll let you want to ask any questions. Anybody want to ask anything? I don't think I can be of much use to you in helping you get ready for that test, but